Hello learners, today the topic of our discussion is on types of teaching aids. We remember 20% of what we hear. We remember 30% of what we see. We remember 50% of what we see and hear. We remember 90% of what we say and do. I hear, I forget. I see, I remember. I do, I understand. Now let's talk about teaching aids. Teaching aids are the tools that teachers use them in the classroom, such as flashcards, maps, cassettes, and blackboard. A teaching aid is a tool used by teachers to help learners improve reading and other skills, illustrate or reinforce a skill, fact, or idea, and relieve anxiety, fears, or boredom, since many teaching aids are like games. Now here is a definition of teaching aids. Teaching materials are the aids used by the facilitator to help him or her in facilitating his or her lesson effectively. And learning materials are the aids used by the learners to help him or her effectively. Both teaching and learning materials can be big or small. The teaching and learning materials can be bought and made easily by both the facilitator and learner. Teaching aids. Teaching aids means which teacher can use for teaching classes in order to help learners to learn easily, effectively, and enjoyably. There are three types of teaching aids which could be used in a class. First is visual, second is audio, and third is audio-visual. Now let's discuss about multimedia. What multimedia actually is. Multi means many or more than one, and media means medium of communication. Multimedia is media and content that uses a combination of different content forms. The term is used in contrast to media, which only use traditional forms of printing or hand-produced materials. Multimedia includes a combination of text, audio, still images, animation video, interactive content forms. Importance of media in the field of education, their use and application. They are used in courseware, simulations, they are used in e-learning or distance learning, and they are used for information searching. Now let's talk about objectives of teaching aids. First one is to enhance teacher skills which help to make teaching learning process effective. The second one is to make learners active in the classroom. Other one is communicate them according to their capabilities. Next is develop lesson plan and build interest. Other one is to make students good observer and to develop easy and understandable learning. Now let's talk about types of teaching aids. There are many teaching aids available these days. We may classify these aids as follows: visual aids, audio aids, and audio visual aids. Now let's talk about visual aids. The aids which use sense of vision are called visual aids. For example, actual objects, models, pictures, charts, maps, flashcards, flannel board, bulletin board, chalkboard, overhead projectors, slides. Out of these, blackboard and chalk are the commonest ones. Now let's talk about audio aids. The aids that involve the sense of hearing are called audio aids. An example for audio aids are radio, tape recorder, gramophone, etc. Now, audio visual aids. The aids which involve the sense of vision as well as hearing are called audio visual aids. And examples of audio visual aids are television, film projector, film strips, etc. Now let's talk about audio aids. Audio refers to sound, and multimedia can include files which contain sounds. Audio songs also come under the heading multimedia. Multimedia presentations often has some audio tracks which makes it easier for people to understand. Moreover, multimedia phones have music players to run audio music, and various audio software include VLC media player, real player, etc. Here are some teaching aids, audio teaching aids, tape recordings, phonograph disc, radio, and mobile phones. Now let's talk about use of audio aids in teaching and learning. In this, auditory materials are used by schools to provide learning experiences of a specific type, that is, experiences of pure learning. Radio and recording are addressed to one sense only. Half of the world's adult population today can listen understandingly, as they can neither read nor write, but they manage effectively with spoken symbols. In ancient times, teaching was basically a matter of oral communication. Greek adults were educated by the spoken words. Moreover, technical inventions made possible our widespread use of printed materials at a time when the spoken word could not travel beyond the range of speaker's voice. Today, the possibilities for oral communication have become virtually limitless. Development of educational radio. And there are two sides of these aspects, and those are, first is the establishment of broadcast network, and the other one is the preparation and production of specific educational programs. It can be viewed in five types: school broadcast, adult education and community development project, farm and home broadcast, fourth is university broadcast, and the last one is language learning projects. Now let's discuss about advantages of radio. First is immediacy. Books tells us about events that may have occurred long ago. Because they are not revised each other, may often be 5 or 10 years out of date. But radio can be as up to date as the latest broadcast. The other advantage is realism. An announcer who tells radio listeners what he sees as he sees it may be more impressive than a newspaper reporter dealing with identical matter. Third one is the consequence of space and time. Through on-the-spot broadcast radio can actually overcome the barriers of space as well as time. Next is emotional impact. Radio brings dramatic feelings into the classroom. It has the warmth of drama, the personal feelings of actor's presence. It can carry to the listener all the emotional overtones of the broadcast materials. The other one is authenticity. Radio has often been used to bring to classrooms the first kind of expertness and authority in subject matter. Expertness in methods is also provided by radio. And the next one is inexpensiveness. Radio can be used inexpensively when there is need to emphasize local problem or conditions of one kind or another, because it reaches many people and its per capita cost is too small. Now let's talk about tape recorder. The tape recorder with which the magnetic tape is used can record a message and play it back a pre-recorded tape. Now, development in recording field. First, it facilitates program exchanges in educational radio, thus stimulating the making of recording in the classroom. Second is, the development of long playing records has led to a supply of educational materials that can be reproduced for an extended, uninterrupted listening period on a smaller machine. Third is, increase in number of outstanding radio programs. And the next one is, a number of textbooks publishers have been preparing records to supplement the reading material. Now, advantages of recordings over the radio. First one is, radio is one way, while recordings are two-way communication. We can stop a recording to clarify certain points and can play it over again and again. It is totally controlled by us. The second one is, radio is inconveniently scheduled. One-time event with recordings eliminate. We can play our transcription wherever we wish. Next is, recording can be reheard and evaluated. Activity can be planned at leisure, carefully, and with the comforting knowledge, as recording is ours to control and not something that control and not something that control our lesson, as in the case of radio. Moreover, recording can be made in our own school, By using simple mechanical aids, we can make our own recordings and use it as teaching aids. Now, here are some types of teaching aids, visual aids: slides, film strips, models, specimens, graphs and charts, picture materials, globes and maps, diagrams, timelines, and tables. Now, types of visual aids. There are many types of visual aids. The first one is PowerPoint or equivalent. Microsoft PowerPoint is probably now the most commonly used form of visual aid. Used well, it can really help you in your presentation. Used badly, however, it can have the opposite effect. And the general principles for using PowerPoint presentation are the do's. Use a big enough font, minimum 20 PT. Keep the background simple. Use animations when appropriate and make things visual. And the don'ts are, don't make it so small that you can't read it. Don't use endless slides of bulleted list that all look the same. Don't use a fussy background image and don't overdo the animation as it gets distracting. Now, overhead projector slides or transparencies. Overhead projector slides and transparencies are displayed on the overhead projector, a very useful tool found in most lecture and seminar rooms. The overhead projector projects and enlarges your slides onto a screen or wall without requiring the lights to be dimmed. You can produce your slides in three ways. First is pre-prepared slides. These can be words or images, either handwritten, drawn, or produced on a computer. The next is spontaneously produced slides. These can be written as you speak to illustrate your points or to record comments from the audience. And then next is a mixture of both. Try adding two pre-prepared slides when making your presentation to show movement, highlight change, or signal detail interrelationships. Now let's talk about whiteboard. White or blackboard can be very useful to explain the sequence of ideas or routines, particular in the sciences. Use them to clarify your title or to record your key points as you introduce your presentation. Rather than expecting the audience to follow your spoken description of an experiment or process, write each stage on the board, including any complex terminology or precise references to help your audience take accurate notes. Now, paper handouts. Handouts are incredibly useful. Use a handout if your information is too detailed to fit on a slide, or if you want your audience to have a full record of your findings. Consider the merits of passing around your handouts at the beginning, middle, and end of a presentation. Given too early and they may prove a distraction. Given too late and your audience may have taken too many unnecessary notes. Given out in the middle and your audience will inevitably read rather than listen. One powerful way of avoiding these pitfalls is to give out incomplete handouts at key stages during your presentation. And the next one is flip chart. A flip chart is a large pad of paper or a stand. It is a very useful and flexible way of recording information during your presentation. You can even use pre-prepared sheets for your keynotes. Record information as you go along, keeping one main idea to each sheet. Flip back through the pad to help you recap your main points. Use the turning of a page to show progression from point to point. Remember to make your writing clear and readable and your diagrams as simple as possible. Other one is video, that is DVDs. Video gives you a chance to show stimulating visual information. Use video to bring movement, pictures, and sound into your presentation. Always make sure that the clip is directly relevant to your content. Tell your audience what to look for. Avoid showing any more film than you need. Now, artifacts or props. Sometimes it can be very useful to use artifacts or props when making a presentation. Think of the safety routine on an aeroplane when the steward shows you how to use the safety equipment. If you bring an artifact with you, make sure that the object can be seen and be prepared to pass it around a small group or move to different areas of a large room to help your audience view it in detail. Remember, this will take time, and that when audience is immersed in looking at an object, they will find it hard to listen to your talk. Conceal large props until you need them. They might distract your audience attention. Now, who can take benefit from aids, visual aids? Though every children can take benefit while using visual aids for learning, but it is more helpful for those students, those who are having language disorder, autism spectrum disorder, Down syndrome, and those who have learning disabilities, students who have English as a secondary language, those who are having optional deficient disorder, personality development delay, and those who have the problem of hearing impairment, and those have the symptoms of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, that is ADHD. Now, let's talk about advantages. It helps to make learning process more effective and conceptual. Moreover, it helps to grab the attention of students. Third one is, it builds interest and motivation teaching students' learning process. Next is, it enhances the energy level of teaching as well as students. Next is, it is even better for overburdened classrooms, and it provides students a realistic approach and experience. And the disadvantages of them are technical problems, students' distraction, they are expensive, they are time consuming, they need space and convenience. Now let's talk about audio visual aids. Materials that help to make learning experiences clear and vivid by appealing to senses are called audio visual aids. The effective application of audio visual aid is known as audiovisual technology or AV technology. Audiovisual aids are also called instructional material. Audio literally means hearing, and visual means that which is found by seeing. So all such aids which endeavor to make the knowledge clear to us through our sense are called audiovisual aids or instructional material. All these learning material make the learning situations as real as possible and give us first-hand knowledge through the organs of hearing and seeing. Therefore, any advice which can be used to make the learning experience more concrete and effective, more realistic and dynamic, can be considered audio-visual materials. Now, here are some types of teaching aids, audio-visual aids: motion pictures, TV, video, dramatization. Now, here are some principles of audio-visual aids. Principle, first one is principle of individual difference. Second is principle of perception. Third one is principle of participation. Next is principle of readiness. Another one is principle of adequacy and appropriateness, and principle of creativity. Now, here are some advantages of audio-visual aids. First is, it helps to learn more and remember for long. Second is, give reality and vividness to learning situation. Third is, it motivates the learner. Next is, it gives clarity to learning. Other one is, it makes the abstract concrete. Next is, it reduces verbalism. It provides variety in methods of teaching and learning. It develops deeper understanding. It arouses curiosity and stimulates self-activity. Moreover, it makes learning interesting, meaningful, as well as permanent. Audio-visual aids. According to Burton, these are sensory objectives and images which stimulate an emphasis on learning process. Moreover, in the words of Carter V. Good, it is a trainable mode process of learning which includes motivation, classification, as well as stimulation. Characteristics of audio-visual aids. First is, they should be meaningful as well as purposeful. Next is, they should be accurate in every aspect. They should be simple. They should be cheap. They should be large enough to be properly seen by students for whom they are meant for. They should be up to date, and they should motivate students. Now, according to intellectual level of students, the sources of audiovisual aids are government, educational institutions, professional organizations, non-governmental organizations, voluntary organizations, which includes national and international, commercial producers of educational material, as well as commercial advertisements. These are all the sources of audiovisual aids. Now, principles which should be followed for the effective use of audiovisual aids. First is, audiovisual materials should function as an integral part of the educational program. Second is, audiovisual aids should be centralized under specialized direction and leadership in educational programs. Other one is, an advisory committee consisting of representatives from all areas of curriculum should be appointed to assist in selection as well as coordination of audiovisual materials. And an educational program should be flexible. Other one is, audiovisual material should be carefully located to eliminate duplication, easy accessibility, and convenient use. Next is, audiovisual material should be available whenever and wherever they need it for effective utilization as integral part of curriculum. Next is, budget appropriations should be made regularly for audiovisual educational programs. Moreover, periodic evaluation to be done to assess the function of utilization and expenditure of the program. Now, here we can see classification of audiovisual aids. They can be divided into two parts, projected aids and non-projected aids. And under projected aids comes hardware, which includes overhead projector, film projector, LCD projector, and under software it comes film strips, transparencies, slides, CDs and DVDs. And under graphic aids, it comes charts, posters, flashcards. And in three-dimensional aids, specimens, models, and in display boards, blackboard and whiteboard. And in print materials, it's pamphlets, leaflets, and under audio aids comes tape recorders. Now let's start with projected audiovisual aids, overhead projector. The overhead projector is the most used in all audiovisual aids. It projects transparencies with brilliant screen images suitable for use in a lighted room. The teacher can write or draw diagrams on the transparency while he teaches. These are projected simultaneously on the screen by the overhead projectors. Other one is overhead transparencies. Transparencies are popular instructional medium. They are simple to prepare and easy to prepare and easy to operate with the overhead projector, which is lightweight. Other one is the opaque projector. It is the only projector on which you can project a variety of materials. For example, book pages, objects, coins, postcards, or any other similar flat material that is non-transparent. Now let's talk about slide projector. A slide is a small piece of transparent material on which a single pictorial image or scene or graphic image has been photographed or reproduced otherwise. The next one is film strips. Film strips are a sequence of transparent still pictures with individual frames on 35mm film. A tape recorded narration can be synchronized with film strips. Under non-projective aids come graphic aids, which are a combination of graphic as well as pictorial material designed for the orderly and logical visualizing of relationship between key facts and ideas. For example, comparisons, relative amounts developments, processes, classification, and organization. And graphic aids include charts, flashcards, posters, graphs, maps. There are many types of maps, political maps, physical map, relief map, weather map, picture or tourist maps, road maps, railway maps, air maps, as well as sea route maps, about newspapers. And now under three-dimensional aids comes models, objects and specimens, display boards and chalkboard. And here are some advantages of using aids: effective virtual and conceptual learning, capturing and sustained attention of students, more permanent learning, provide near reality experience, saving energy and time, meet individual demands, education of masses, provide opportunity for students to learn, moreover arising interest and motivating the students to learn. Now here are some limitations of audiovisual aids. First is ineffectiveness of the aids. financial hurdles, absence of electricity, and improper sections of aids. Thank you.